Hi, my name is Osama Naga. I will continue the pediatric board review series explaining the content of the pediatric board study guide. In this video, we'll discuss part two of the gastroenterology chapter, upper GI and part of the lower GI disorders. You can start with me now in part two from page 265 to page 276. We'll start from the top down with a clinical case scenario. This is a one-day-old premature boy with history of maternal polyhydramnios, presents with copious, fine, white, frothy bubbles of mucus in the mouth and the nose. Secretions recur despite suctioning. Baby developed episodes of coughing, choking in association with cyanosis. If you look at the x-ray here, you are, after trying to pass the NG tube or the feeding tube, the tube returned back here and coiling. And filled to pass down to the stomach, and this is a classic finding in oesophageal atresia. Also, if you look at the stomach area, it has a gas bubble, which is the gas escaped from the trachea down to the esophagus from the distal esophagus because of associated tracheoesophageal fistula. Also, if you look at the CT scan here, it shows the blind esophagus. And successfully after the operation, the NG tube passed down to the stomach. This is a presentation of esophageal atresia in 1 day old boy. The most common type of esophageal atresia is a combination of blind upper esophagus and tracheoesophageal fistula connected to the distal esophagus. The most common missed type, which is actually rare but is commonly missed, is H type, which is a small connection between the esophagus and the trachea through the tracheoesophageal fistula. It is diagnosed later in life due to a chronic respiratory problem, for example, recurrent pneumonia or wheezing. Non-syndromic is 50%, syndromic is the rest. For example, of syndromic type is vectoral or vitreo. Vectoral is a vertebral anomalies, anal atresia, cardiac defects, tracheoesophageal fistula, esophageal atresia, renal radial anomalies, and LEMP. This figure explains the most common type esophageal atresia with distal tracheoesophageal fistula. You will see here the esophagus is blind and is not connected to the esophagus down. And if you try to pass the NG tube or the feeding tube, it will coil and return back here and will not pass down to the stomach. And the distal esophagus is connected to the trachea through the tracheoesophageal fistula. This is the most common type and usually diagnosed early in life in the first day. The rare type, which is really commonly missed, is the H type. They call it H type because it looks like H letter, which is a connection between the esophagus and the trachea through a small fistula. There is no interruption in the esophagus. You will be able to pass the NG tube down to the stomach with no problem. This patient, they may present later in life with recurrent cough, wheezing, and pneumonia because of escaping the gastric content or milk or food down to the trachea. A clinical presentation of esophageal atresia, frothing, bubbling, cyanosis, respiratory distress, and coughing. Maternal history of polyhydramnios is important. Diagnosis and ability to pass the nasogastric tube, as we saw in the previous case. Plain radiograph will show coil nasogastric tube in the esophageal pouch. Air distended stomach indicate tracheoesophageal fistula. Management is oral surgery. Rumination. Rumination is a behavioral problem. The definition of rumination: voluntarily habitual effortless regurgitation of recently ingested food. It may be expelled from the mouth or re-swallowed again. The symptoms do not occur during sleep, that's why it's behavioral, and do not respond to the standard treatment of reflux. Diagnosis of rumination is a clinical diagnosis, require no investigation. Symptoms must be present more than 8 weeks. Rumination is not associated with retching. Associated conditions: intellectual disability, bulimia or depression, underlying psychological disturbances. Management of rumination: it's a multidisciplinary approach and team approach, behavioral therapy and biofeedback. Tricyclic antidepressants may be helpful and nutritional support. Gastroesophageal reflux: it's a passage of gastric contents into the esophagus. It's a normal process, physiologic process in healthy infants. It usually occurs after feeds. The amount of milk they reflux is varies between small amount to larger amount, which can cause a lot of distress to the parents and caregiver and frequent visits to the doctor. But anyhow, the child is healthy, happy and gaining weight and does not have any symptoms. 80% resolve by 6 months and 90% resolve by 12 months with no medication. It requires only reassurance. Gastroesophageal reflux disease may start at the same time like esophageal reflux in the first few months and peak at 4 months and resolve by 12 months and all gone by 24 months. The difference is that GERD associated with symptom, for example fussiness, sleep disturbance and decreased appetite. Clinical presentation of GERD in infants, irritability, arching like Sandifier syndrome and sometimes mistaken for seizure, choking, gagging, feeding aversion, failure to thrive, aspiration pneumonitis, obstructive apnea. GERD may present in preschool and school-aged children with regurgitation, vomiting, abdominal pain, and feeding difficulties. Also may present with cough, pneumonia, and dental erosions. In older children, they are able to point out the pain more. They may present with heartburn, regurgitation, and epigastric pain. Also may present with cough, recurrent pneumonia, and dental erosions. In severe cases, may present with hematemesis and anemia. Diagnosis of GERD is by history and physical examination. Further diagnostic testing is not necessary to diagnose gastroesophageal reflux or GERD. Empirical trial also can be used using PPI for 4 weeks a trial. If the symptom disappear, this can be diagnostic and very helpful. So again, no investigation is necessary to diagnose GERD. If the parents presented to you with gastroesophageal reflux by history and physical examination, you can go ahead and treat and no need for upper GI or other testing. Indication for investigation for GERD is complication related to GERD, if any complication associated with GERD, or to evaluate for other causes of vomiting. Investigation you may start with upper GI series, and this can show reflux, as we'll see in the next slide, esophageal pH monitoring, endoscopy, and gastric MT scan. As you see here, this is a barium swallow, and you see some of the barium in the lower third of the esophagus. This is a case of mild reflux. Management of GERD. Lifestyle modifications. Decrease the volume of the formula. This can be helpful, but you have to increase the caloric density in order to allow the child to receive the same caloric amount and continue to grow. I will show you an example here how you can do that. If you give 32 ounces per day of 20 calorie per ounce formula, this will give you at the end 640 calorie per day. You can decrease from 32 to 27 ounces per day or 24 ounces per day, but you have to change the formula to 24 calorie per ounce or 26 calorie per ounce. And this at the end will give you the same caloric amount required for this child. Also, you can do these changes by changing the amount of water ratio to the amount of powder. This will increase the density or the caloric density of the formula. You can do that also by adding rice cereal, and the rice cereal will increase the caloric density of the formula as well. Short trial of hypoallergenic formula can be very helpful, for example using Nutramigen or Alimentum, but you need to use it at least for 2 weeks to allow the gastric mucosa to heal. So if the parents, they return back to you 2 to 3 days after, frustrated because the child is still vomiting, you need to reassure them and continue the formula for 2 weeks at least in order to see effect. And this will help you exclude cow's milk or soy milk protein allergy. If breastfeeding, the mother may exclude the cow's milk products from her diet. And if the vomiting stops, and the child start to gain weight, and this is actually suggestive of soy or cow's milk protein allergy. Also, the parents can be advised to elevate the head of the bed for the child or carry the child in upright position after each feed. Management of GERD. H2 receptor antagonists, for example ranitidine, can be used in the management of GERD in infants and the children. Proton pump inhibitor like omeprazole, lansoprazole, pantoprazole can be used as well. But you need to use them for at least 4 weeks in order to see effect. Prokinetics, they work by stimulating more rapid emptying of the stomach, and they are useful in the patient with delayed gastric emptying. For example, metoclopramide and erythromycin. Metoclopramide, you need to know the side effect of metoclopramide. For example, dystonic reactions, lethargy, irritability, gynecomastia, permanent tardive dyskinesia, and discuss these side effects with parents. Erythromycin can cause prolonged QT interval as well. After trying the hypoallergenic formula for 2 weeks, PPIs for at least 4 weeks, and rolling out all the other possible causes of vomiting, for example, pyloric stenosis, intracranial tumor, or metabolic causes, and the patient is still vomiting, not gaining weight, it is very appropriate to do consultation to pediatric gastroenterology at this point. In severe cases of GERD associated with complications and not responding to any treatment, Nissen fundoplication is the final solution. Eosinophilic esophagitis. It is because of infiltration of esophageal epithelium with eosinophils. Food allergy is the most common cause of eosinophilic esophagitis. Clinical presentation, vomiting, chest pain, epigastric pain, dysphagia, food impaction for because of stricture. You should suspect that in any adolescent present with new onset of food impaction. And also you should suspect this type of condition when you give anti-reflux therapy and is not working for the patient. Endoscopy with biopsy is the mainstay for the diagnosis of eosinophilic esophagitis. Common lab finding: elevated eosinophil, elevated IgE level. It is very important to do food allergy testing to determine the causative agent. Treatment: elimination of diet with proven allergies or elemental diet. Inhaled and systemic steroid and montelukast can help with the inflammation, but once you discontinue this agency, the inflammation may return back. Repeat endoscopies with biopsies are often necessary to ensure improvement. If the patient left untreated, the esophageal stricture will occur and can cause food impaction and other complications. Esophageal varices. Causes of esophageal varices: portal hypertension. This is the most common. Cavernous or portal vein thrombosis is a common cause of portal hypertension in children. Umbilical vein thrombosis in neonates. So history here is very important to ask about the previous history of umbilical vein catheterization when the child was in the NICU. Mediastinal tumor, superior vena cava thrombosis. These children may present with hematemesis or vomiting blood and splenomegaly. Diagnosis of esophageal varices: upper endoscopy. Management: treatment of the cause, sclerotherapy, beta blocker may prevent esophageal bleeding. This is an endoscopic figure of the esophagus with esophageal varices. You can see here the veins are dilated and tortuous. This is esophageal varices in the esophagus. Clinical case scenario. This is a 15 years old boy with history of a severe migraine headache. Presents with dysphagia and chest pain. He does not like to drink water with medicine. What is the most likely cause? Pill-induced esophagitis, peptic ulcer, myocarditis, musculoskeletal pain, and Helicobacter pylori. So the key word in this question: severe migraine, or any patient present with chronic condition requiring pain medicine. He's presenting with dysphagia and he does not like to drink water with medicine. So you have to ask these questions in order for you to come up with this diagnosis. So history here is diagnostic. So this patient had pill-induced esophagitis. Pill-induced esophagitis is a very interesting condition, and the history here is the key to diagnose this condition. It is caused by local or topical injury when the pills or the medicine directly contacted the esophageal mucosa and cause caustic injuries. The extent of the injuries, it depends on the chemical nature of the medicine, how soluble is the medicine, the contact time, the size and shape of the medicine, the amount of water the person or the child is drinking. If the child has a pre-existing condition, for example, if he has a stricture or achalasia, common medication can cause that, NSAIDs, so you need to ask about history of headache or arthritis. So the ibuprofen, aspirin, or naproxen can cause that. If the child has acne and taking doxycycline or tetracycline, management is to advise the child to drink plenty of water, or to ask the parents to encourage the child to drink plenty of water when taking pills. Ingestion of foreign body or foreign body in the esophagus. This is a very important subject. The most common age of ingestion is between 6 months and 3 years, but can occur in any age. The coins and the small toys are the most commonly ingested items in children. The most common site is the upper esophageal sphincter is 70%, and the mid esophagus, which is the arch of the aorta, is about 20%, and superior to the diaphragm at the lower esophageal sphincter is about 10%. Clinical presentation of foreign body in the esophagus, 30% of the cases are asymptomatic. This is very important to know. So history of ingestion should be taken seriously and investigated even with no symptom. So if the parents, they told you that the child swallowed a coin and there is no symptom, you have to do the examination and take a chest x-ray, abdominal x-ray, and even neck x-ray. If the child develop any symptoms, it will be initial bouts of choking, gagging and coughing. This may be followed by salivation, dysphagia or difficult swallowing and refusal to eat. Patient may present with vomiting, pain in the neck and throat area, stridor, wheezing, cyanosis or dyspnea, especially if the foreign body impinge on the larynx. Worst case scenario is perforation, where you can find swelling in the cervical area, erythema and subcutaneous crepitations and feeling air under the skin. If the history suggests ingestion of the foreign body, you must take x-ray, even if there is no symptoms. The x-ray you take AP and lateral view for the neck, chest and abdomen. So, but you have to know there is two types of foreign body, radiolucent where you cannot see in the x-ray most of the time, and radioopaque where you can see in the x-ray most of the time. So radiolucent example, most of the foods, wood, splinters, thorns, fish bones, plastics and aluminum. Radioopaque, which is easy to see in x-ray, glass, all type of glasses, metal, except aluminum, some food and medications. This x-ray just to show the difference if the coin in the esophagus or in the trachea. When you do AP or PA view, the face of the coin will be like that if it's in the esophagus. So you will see the face of the coin appears in the AP or PA view if it's in the esophagus, and the edge in the lateral view if it's in the esophagus. Here, this foreign body in the trachea, in the AP or PA view, you will see the edge of the coin. So this one is laying in the trachea, not in the esophagus. And the lateral view, you will see the face of the coin in the lateral view. So this foreign body is in the trachea. This figure just to show you the difference between coin and battery in the esophagus. This is a frontal projection where you can see the face of the coin in the esophagus. So, and also this battery, it's in the esophagus because you see the face of the coin in the AP view or the frontal projection. So for the coin, it's all solid, there is no edges. Here there is a double edge and there is a hollow. There is a double edge and a hollow. So this is a battery, this is a coin. Management of the foreign body in the esophagus. Batteries must be removed immediately. Batteries, they can cause mucosal injury as little as 1 hour, and they involve all the esophageal layer within 4 hours. So they must be removed immediately. So observation of batteries in the esophagus is not acceptable. But on the other hand, asymptomatic blunt object, like for example coin, can be observed for 24 hours, but longer than that can cause pressure necrosis and must be removed, even with no symptoms. If the patient is symptomatic with any foreign body in the esophagus, regardless what type of foreign body, has to be removed. So with symptom, you remove immediately. Without symptoms, if a blunt foreign body, for example like coin, can be observed within 24 hours. For batteries in the esophagus, has to be removed immediately. If there is no history of esophageal surgery, you may use glucagon, can be used to facilitate the passage by decreasing the lower esophageal sphincter pressure. Esophageal trauma because of ingestion of caustic agents like acid and alkaline, it's more common in males. Between age 1 and 3 years of age is the most common. You have two types, alkaline and acid. Alkaline can give you obvious injuries in the mouth, in the lips, in the pharynx. It also can cause in the esophagus. So it's easy for you when a patient presents you, you may see the injuries obvious to you. On the other hand, the acid, you may not see injuries obvious to you when the patient presented to you, but may have injuries in the stomach. So history here is very important. So you cannot ignore the history if the patient or the parents confirm that the child ingested acidic agent. So the child must be investigated, and you keep in consideration the child may have severe injuries in the stomach. Clinical presentation, dysphagia or difficulty swallowing, drooling, abdominal pain, hematemesis, and respiratory distress because of aspiration. Management. Avoid neutralizing agents. Don't act like a chemist. Do not do vinegar or sodium bicarbonate. This can cause more burn. Endoscopy is indicated after 6 hours to document full extent of injuries. Endoscopy should not be later than 4 days post-ingestion to minimize perforation. Complication is esophageal stricture. Prevention, how to prevent that? By keeping all the chemical in their original containers away from each other. Why original container? So not to be mistaken with juices or drinks or any other material. So again, it's very important when a patient presents to you with acid or alkaline, the history, if the history is positive, it must be investigated with endoscopy. Clinical approach to a child present with vomiting. Diagnostic clues to a child presenting with vomiting. If the child present with fever with or without abdominal pain, the possible causes are gastroenteritis. Gastroenteritis may present with vomiting in the beginning without diarrhea. When the diarrhea comes, this will make it easy to make the diagnosis of gastroenteritis. UTIs or urine infection can present only with vomiting and without dysuria, without urinary symptom. Any child present with vomiting, you have to keep the urine infection in the top of your differential list and test the urine. It's a simple test. And also you may ask about the previous history of UTIs, history of constipation, family history of UTI or renal diseases. Systemic infection also can present with vomiting. Appendicitis. Appendicitis, the younger the children, the more difficult to diagnose appendicitis and is easy to miss. So appendicitis may present with vomiting, with or without abdominal pain, with or without fever. So you have to keep it in mind. So the only way not to miss it, to keep it in your differential, especially in infants and younger children. Projectile vomiting, non-bilious, is a classic presentation of pyloric stenosis. However, preterm infants may not present with projectile vomiting, and they present with non-bilious persistent vomiting in the first 2 to 3 weeks of age, and also they may present later than full-term infants. Undigested food is a clue for achalasia. It's rare but is possible. Bilious vomiting or bile stained vomiting, it's a diagnostic clue for surgical emergencies. For example, volvulus intussusception or any bowel obstruction, for example, duodenal atresia. But you need to know that single episode of bilious vomiting in infant or children, and if there is no symptom, physical examination is normal, the child is happy, or the infant is feeding well with no symptoms, it's normal or can be normal and require no investigation unless it is persistent. A bulging fontanelle or increased intracranial pressure, for example, meningitis or intracranial tumor. Adolescence presents with vomiting with or without abdominal pain. This can be pregnancy, and you need to test adolescent when they present with vomiting and no other clue for pregnancy. Drugs and bulimia. Cyclic vomiting. Cyclic vomiting, it's a recurrent episode of vomiting, and the child stays normal for a while, like for 2 to 3 weeks, for 1 month or 2 months, then start to vomit again. And you cannot really identify a specific cause for the vomiting. This condition may be associated with migraine, or it may be equivalent to the migraine. Especially if the family history is positive for migraine, this can be very helpful. Clinical presentation. The prodrome similar to a brain or head migraine, they may present with a pallor, intolerance to noise, light, nausea, lethargy, a headache, or fever before the symptom of the vomiting start. Precipitant excitement, infection, or stress. The average episodes of vomiting, 12 episodes per year, and the child normal in between the episode. Each episode may last 1 to 2-3 days with 4 or more emesis per hour. Diagnosis of cyclic vomiting is a diagnosis of exclusion. You need to rule out all the organic causes of vomiting before you come to the diagnosis of cyclic vomiting. Endoscopy and upper GI will help to identify any organic or anatomical problem in the GI tract that may cause vomiting. Brain MRI to rule out brain tumor or any organic cause in the brain that may cause increased intracranial pressure and subsequent vomiting. Metabolic disorders associated with vomiting also need to be ruled out. Treatment is mainly supportive. To keep the patient hydrated by supplementing plenty of fluids and electrolytes. ondansetron or Zofran to help to minimize or decrease or prevent the vomiting and decrease the chance of dehydration and subsequent hospitalization. Sumatriptan will help to abort the cyclic vomiting in children and adults the same way you use it for head migraine. Also, the same way you prevent the head migraine, also you may be able to prevent the cyclic vomiting by using amitriptyline, ciproheptadine, propranolol, preventive dose for the same dose you are using for preventive dose for head migraine, you can use it also for cyclic vomiting. Peptic ulcer disease, it's rare in children. The most common cause is Helicobacter pylori bacteria. The clinical presentation, abdominal pain, indigestion, and dyspepsia. Diagnosis for peptic ulcer disease. Of course, after the history and physical examination, the best screening tool to screen for peptic ulcer disease, the best two labs you can order, any of them, is fecal antigen and urea breath test. So you can order either fecal antigen or urea breath testing for a screening. This is the best two screening tools you can use for peptic ulcer disease. Bad screening tool is serum antibodies. Please do not order this test for any patient to screen for peptic ulcer disease. This test is not reliable. The blood test for Helicobacter pylori antibodies may indicate past infection. So do not choose this test in the board. Do not order it for your patients. It's just a waste. The gold standard test for peptic ulcer disease is upper GI endoscopy with biopsy. This is an endoscopic picture of a patient with Helicobacter pylori. You can see here the nodularities in the gastric mucosa. This is unique about the Helicobacter pylori infection, the nodularity in the wall of the gastric mucosa. This is an endoscopic figure of a child with large duodenal ulcer. This is the cherry red spot, and this shows the site of the bleeding blood vessel. Treatment of peptic ulcer disease, proton pump inhibitors for 1 month. So you need to use proton pump inhibitor for 1 month, plus two antibiotics for 14 days. So PPI for 1 month, plus two antibiotics for 14 days. The recommended combination of antibiotics, amoxicillin twice a day plus clarithromycin twice a day, or metronidazole twice a day plus clarithromycin twice a day, or amoxicillin twice a day plus metronidazole twice a day. Follow-up testing after the treatment of peptic ulcer disease. So if you give triple therapy for 2 weeks, for example, PPI, amoxicillin, and clarithromycin, so triple therapy for 2 weeks, then you need to give another 2 weeks of PPIs with no antibiotic. So PPI only with no antibiotics. Then afterward, you need to wait another 2 weeks in order to do the follow-up testing. The follow-up testing, you can do stool test for a Helicobacter pylori antigen or urea breath testing. So the follow-up test has to be 2 weeks from the last dose of PPI and 4 weeks from the last dose of the oral antibiotic. So 4 weeks from the last dose of oral antibiotic and 2 weeks from the last dose of PPI. Then the test will be informative, will be more accurate for follow-up and ensuring the eradication of the bacteria from the stomach. So if the patient has no symptom and the test is negative, the treatment is successful. But if the patient continue to have symptoms or the test is positive, the best way is to refer for endoscopy and further investigation. Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. This is a rare cause of a recurrent and persistent peptic ulcer disease. It is caused by gastrin secreting tumor of the pancreas that stimulates the acid secreting cells and cause ulceration in the gastrointestinal mucosa. Clinical presentation, abdominal pain, recurrent gastritis, intractable to treatment, diarrhea and hypoglycemia. This is important. Diagnosis of Zollinger-Ellison syndrome is fasting serum gastrin level will be very high. Serum calcium for men syndrome to rule out other associated endocrinopathy, for example, hyperparathyroidism, pancreatic endocrine tumor, and pituitary tumor. Management is proton pump inhibitors and surgery if no hepatic metastasis. Foreign body in the stomach. Once in the foreign body in the stomach, 95% of all ingested objects will pass with no problem. Perforation is rare, is less than 1%. The management to observation, you don't need to do anything, just reassure the parents. Most of the objects will take about 4 to 6 days will pass, and you will find it in the stool. Sometimes it takes longer, up to 3 to 4 weeks. So follow up always after 1 month. Removal of the foreign body from the stomach if is unlikely to pass through the duodenum, especially if it's very large. So if you have more than 3 centimeters in length, any object in infants and toddlers need to be removed. More than 5 centimeters in older children, thin objects more than 10 centimeters and didn't go through the duodenum, open safety pin also need to be removed, and all magnets has to be removed. Sharp pain in the stomach can be observed, just to reassure the parents. So sharp pain can be observed, there is no need to worry. And objects in the rectum can be observed 12 to 24 hours. Besides, it's accumulation of indigestible exogenous material in the stomach and the intestine. It may occur in the children with psychiatric illness or intellectual disability, especially if you see here in the stomach or what is well known as trichobezoars. Lactobezoars also, like milk products and the chewing gums, can be found. Clinical presentation: gastric outlet obstruction, anorexia, vomiting, weight loss, severe halitosis, abdominal pain, and distension. Diagnosis: KOB or plain film, ultrasound, or CT scan. The management is removal, endoscopic removal. If the endoscopy is not successful, surgery. Lactobezoar or milk products may resolve if you withhold the feeding for 24 to 48 hours. Pyloric stenosis, it is an acquired condition. It is not congenital. So the child is not born with pyloric stenosis. The etiology is unknown. It is also known as infantile hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. The incidence is 1 to 3 over 1,000. It is more common in males, at least 4 to 8 times more than the females, but can occur in females, especially the first newborn, but also can occur in the second, third, or fourth newborn. The first 3 weeks, or after the first 3 weeks of age, this is the most common age of presentation. Keep in mind, it can occur anytime between birth and 5 months of age. Clinical presentation of pyloric stenosis presents with non-bilious vomiting, usually immediately after feeding, may or may not projectile initially, but usually progressive and become projectile. After vomiting, the infant is hungry. Also, when the vomiting persists more, the child becomes dehydrated, lethargic, weak. Also, in the physical examination, you may feel olive-like mass palpable in the right upper quadrant. The child, because of dehydration, may become jaundiced, but when you hydrate the child, the jaundice will disappear. Laboratory, when you do a lab for a child with pyloric stenosis, you will find the potassium is low and the chloride is low, and they have metabolic alkalosis and what is well known as hypochloremic metabolic alkalosis. So serum potassium usually maintained, but there may be total potassium body deficit. So keep in mind, if you see the potassium a little bit low or normal, this doesn't mean that the child is not hypokalemic. Ultrasound, this is the best study or study of choice for pyloric stenosis. The significance here, if you see the pyloric thickness more than 4 millimeters and the pyloric length is more than 14 millimeter. This is a 4 weeks old boy, presents with projectile non-bilious vomiting immediately after each feed. The child is lethargic, has less number of diaper, of wet diaper. Laboratory work shows hypochloremic, hypokalemic, metabolic alkalosis. Here, if you look at the length of the pylorus, here is 25.6, more than 14 millimeter. And the thickness of the pylorus here is more than 4 millimeter. It is 4.2. So this is a case of pyloric stenosis. Management of pyloric stenosis, you keep the child NPO, nothing by mouth. Then you have to correct the dehydration and electrolyte imbalance. This is the most important step in the management of pyloric stenosis, to rehydrate the child first by giving a bolus and then give the child IV fluid to correct the electrolyte imbalance and the acid-base imbalance. correction of alkalosis is very important to prevent apnea after anesthesia. The treatment is surgery, is pyloromyotomy. Post-operative care in most infant feeding can be initiated within 12 to 24 hours after surgery. You start with frequent small feeding and increasing gradually. Apnea may occur after surgery, so you have to keep in mind. Apnea may occur after surgery. Antral web can be confused with pyloric stenosis. Pyloric stenosis is acquired, antral web is congenital. Pyloric stenosis presents at 3 weeks of life, but a congenital antral web may present at birth or at any age, depending on the degree of obstruction. Normal birth usually wait at, in the cases of pyloric stenosis, antral web usually they have a low birth weight. No history of polyhydramnios, they may have history of polyhydramnios. Non-bilious vomiting, both of them they have non-bilious vomiting. The study of choice for pyloric stenosis is ultrasound. Ultrasound is also a good option for antral web, but they may need upper GI or even endoscopy. Treatment for both is surgery. This is a 1 day old boy with Down syndrome presenting with bilious vomiting. So the presentation is after birth. The child has a Down syndrome and presenting with bilious vomiting. You order a KOB or abdominal X-ray. You will find double bubble sign, and distal to the obstruction there is no gas or any leucences. You may know this diagnosis prenatally if the OBGYN detected an ultrasound and they will see double bubble signs. So they may tell you this child has duodenal atresia, so you will be ready. So when you have early presentation after birth, a child with syndrome or other congenital anomalies present with bilious vomiting and there is a double bubble sign, this is a classic presentation of duodenal atresia. If this is a duodenal obstruction, the child will present with triple bubble sign in duodenal atresia. Duodenal atresia, it's a rare condition because of obstruction of duodenum. May be detected early before birth because of associated polyhydramnios, and the prenatal ultrasound may show the double bubble sign. This is a rare condition, 1 over 10,000 incidents associated with syndrome, for example Down syndrome, 20 to 30%, but may be also associated with other congenital anomalies, esophageal atresia, congenital heart disease, anorectal and renal anomalies. So very important to search for other anomalies when you present with duodenal atresia. Clinical presentation of duodenal atresia, bilious vomiting in the first day of life, so present early after birth. No abdominal distension, the child may have jaundice because of dehydration. Also, history of polyhydramnios is very important, so these children may have history of polyhydramnios. Remember, if you present to an older infant with Down syndrome, like 4 weeks of age, present with non-bilious vomiting, you order ultrasound, not KUB, because you suspect pyloric stenosis. Duodenal atresia present early and present with bilious vomiting, present after birth with bilious vomiting. Even if they thrown the question Down syndrome, but the vomiting in non-bilious and 4 weeks old, for example, you order ultrasound because you suspect pyloric stenosis, not duodenal atresia. Diagnosis of duodenal atresia, KUB, is very unique and specific. You will be able to see the double bubble sign and the absence of gas distal to the obstruction. Management: nasogastric tube for decompression, electrolyte replacement because of the persistent vomiting, echoradiology of the chest spine, also to evaluate for other associated life-threatening anomalies, surgical consultation for correction. Annular pancreas, commonly associated condition with annular pancreas. If you take prenatal history, the mom may have polyhydramnios, also commonly associated with Down syndrome. So any obstruction, like for example esophageal atresia, antral web, duodenal atresia, you may have a history of polyhydramnios. So OBGYN, actually when the mom has polyhydramnios, they look for these congenital anomalies. Also commonly associated with Down syndrome or syndrome. 50% develop symptoms during adulthood. Low birth weight and feeding intolerance immediately after birth. They present with vomiting. Diagnosis ultrasound, KUB, also upper GI or CT scan. The treatment is surgical correction. Superior mesenteric artery syndrome is a compression of duodenum after rapid weight loss. So your key to suspect the supramesenteric artery syndrome is rapid weight loss, like after surgery or any condition associated with rapid weight loss. So what happened here? Loss of mesenteric fat because of rapid weight loss, and this will cause compression of the duodenum. So the superior mesenteric artery will compress, will be collapsed on the duodenum. So the duodenum will be compressed by the superior mesenteric artery in the front and the aorta in the back. The superior mesenteric artery in the front and the aorta in the back. Clinical presentation: epigastric pain, irritation, nausea, voluminous vomiting, it could be bilious or partially digested food, postprandial discomfort, early satiety, so the patient feel full earlier. Position usually relieve the pain. If the patient stay in the left lateral decubitus in the left side, or prone or knee chest position, this may relieve the pain. Diagnosis: upper GI, you will see the duodenum cut off just right to the midline, and the proximal duodenal and gastric dilation. Management: nutrition, lateral or prone position, metoclopramide, nasojejunal to bypass the obstruction, nasojejunal tube, total parenteral nutrition if everything fails, surgical intervention rarely required. Constipation: this is a very important subject. How the constipation occur? If the child, for example, start to have painful bowel movement, or too busy, or has a stress, or new home, or traveling, or dietary changes, so anything to prevent the child to use the bathroom. This will cause prolonged withholding, result in fecal stasis, so this stool stays longer in the colon, and this will cause fluid reabsorption, so the stool become harder and drier and larger, and this will decrease the muscle tone, so the muscle will be dilated and decrease peristalsis, and this will cause fecal impaction. And when you have fecal impaction, the liquid stool will pass around and will cause encopresis, and sometimes the parent will misunderstand it as diarrhea. But the key here is to ask about history of constipation. Other causes of constipation: aganglionosis, Hirschsprung disease. You should ask about history of delayed meconium after the first 48 hours after birth. This can be a hint for you for the diagnosis of Hirschsprung disease if it present later in life. Spinal cord dysplasia or hypotonia, always check the back for any child present with constipation. Check for any spina bifida or any anomalies in the spine. Botulism, infants present with botulism may be the initial presentation only constipation. So any infants present recently with recent constipation, ask about history of exposure to botulism spore, like for example bee honey in the first year. Other causes of constipation: obstructions, like for example meconium ileus, cystic fibrosis, anterior inner ring, and small left colon in a baby born to a mom with diabetes. Other causes of constipation: hypothyroidism, always palpate the thyroid, ask about family history of hypothyroidism or thyroid diseases. Diabetes mellitus, ask about history of taking medication, for example vitamin like iron. Iron can cause constipation and lead poisoning. Clinical presentation of constipation: abdominal pain. This is a very common presentation of constipation. The pain can be mild, moderate, and severe. The pain can be dramatic and even confused with acute abdomen. But the key here is to ask about history of constipation before and ask about the bowel movement. The stool can be large and the color bar is very large and cause pain when the child goes to the bathroom. Encopresis. Encopresis can be mistaken with diarrhea, but it is not diarrhea. It's just a liquid stool passing around the fecal impaction or the hard stool in the rectum. When you do digital rectal exam, you will find abundant stool in the rectum. So this the rectum is full of stool. Anal fissure, of course, and rectal bleeding. This is a KOB of a 5 years old boy presented to me with history of constipation. The reason mom brought him to the clinic because he has a continuous leakage or continuous staining of the underwear with stool. The mom was concerned he may have diarrhea as well. The KOB was ordered and showed a lot of stool throughout the colon down to the rectum. So this child had a fecal impaction with encopresis. NG tube was inserted, go lightly was given as inpatient via the NG tube, and this child had bowel cleaning and all the stool was removed, and afterward the child was placed in maintenance treatment for constipation to prevent the recurrence of constipation with lifestyle modification. So this is the only way to manage this condition. If a child presents with impaction, you have to do bowel cleaning. Then afterward, you have to place the child on maintenance treatment to prevent constipation. For example, ethylene glycol or Miralax as outpatient in daily basis, not as needed. Management of constipation, number one, behavioral modification. Behavioral modification is the key. So when the child has the urge to go to the bathroom, he has to go, or she has to go. Also, the child has to stay in the bathroom at least 10 to 15 minutes twice a day, even if there is no urge, drinking lots of water. So this is very important before starting medication to educate the parents about behavioral modification. Polyethylene glycol or Miralax can be used as outpatient. It is safe and effective. So if it's used in daily basis, not as needed. Then disimpaction is very important. If the patient is impacted, you have to get the stool out first. Then after that, you give the maintenance treatment as outpatient. If the patient presents with simple constipation, with no retention, with no impaction, you can give a laxative or increase fiber in the diet with drinking lots of water. This can solve the problem. Anal fissure. Anal fissure, it's a laceration in the anal mucosa, in the anal mucosal junction, the mucocutaneous junction. So this can cause bleeding. A forceful passage of a hard stool and large diameter stool. So always ask about history of constipation. This can be seen in infants, even with soft stool. A clinical presentation, constipation. So there is a history of constipation, painful bowel movement. And actually, when you have that, this will exacerbate the constipation, because constipation will bring more constipation, which will result in a harder and larger diameter stool and more anal fissures. Diagnosis, inspection of perianal area, very important. Skin tags, you may see hard stool in the ampulla, or if you do a digital rectal exam, you will see the rectal vault is full of stool. Treatment of constipation, of course. You can, if the child has a painful bowel movement, you can apply topical lidocaine or Imla if it's painful, sitz bath, and stool softener, so you give laxatives. Hirschsprung disease is the most common cause of intestinal obstruction in neonates, and it is very important to keep in your differential when a child presents with constipation and not responding to treatment. Associated also with some syndromes, or can be associated with syndromes, for example, Down syndrome, Smith-Lemli-Optis syndrome, Waardenburg syndrome. Red flag for Hirschsprung disease, delayed passage of meconium after the first 48 hours after birth. So after birth, if you have a neonate not passing the stool in the first 48 hours, one of your differential is Hirschsprung. Other differential, of course, cystic fibrosis or meconium ileus. Know that 99% of normal full-term infants will pass meconium in the first 48 hours. Pathophysiology of Hirschsprung disease is absent ganglionic cells in the one piece of the bowel, or can be small segment, could be larger than that. So this area is the narrow segment. There is no ganglionic cells in this area. That's why it's obstructed. There is a loss of peristalsis. This area doesn't have any function. So it's an area of obstruction. And the proximal area is dilated. This is the healthy area, but it's dilated due to accumulation of the stool in this area. Why this happened? Because of failure of migration of neuroblasts from the proximal segment down to the distal segment. The difference between Hirschsprung and constipation. In constipation, the infant will pass the stool in the first 48 hours. Commonly, with Hirschsprung, you will have delay in the passage of meconium more than 48 hours. However, it can happen also, they may have meconium in the first 48 hours. But if this happens, is a red flag for Hirschsprung disease or even cystic fibrosis. If you do digital rectal exam, the rectal vault here will be full of stool, here will be empty. The stool here is large diameter, here is small diameter. So in Hirschsprung, very thin stool, here is a larger diameter in cases of constipation. If biopsy is done, you will see normal ganglionic cells in the submucosal area, and here will be absent ganglionic cells or lack of ganglionic cells in the submucosal area. The constipation associated with encopresis, or can be associated with encopresis. Encopresis is not associated with Hirschsprung disease. Clinical presentation of Hirschsprung disease constipation. Constipation due to obstruction or functional obstruction in the distal colon, and this will cause dilation in the proximal segments and the accumulation of the stool. Also, the patient may present with enterocolitis and even diarrhea. Stasis can lead to enterocolitis and overgrowth of bacteria, for example, C. diff, staph, and anaerobe. Actually, this can cause perforation and life-threatening sepsis. So this is one of the worst complications can occur with Hirschsprung disease. Stool diameter is small and thin. In the constipation, the stool diameter is larger and the stool is harder. Rectal examination will make the difference. So it's very important to do the rectal exam for any child with constipation or severe constipation. You will see elevated anal tone in Hirschsprung disease. The rectal vault is empty, there is no stool, and explosive foul smelling feces and gases. And if you do it once, you will never forget. Unusual presentation of Hirschsprung disease: if the newborn or the infant pass the meconium in the first 48 hours, then present later with recurrent constipation. This will be misleading a little bit. But if you keep in your mind the Hirschsprung in your differential, and you know the unusual presentation or atypical presentation, and you do the digital rectal exam or the anal tone or even barium enema, you will not miss Hirschsprung disease. Hirschsprung disease can be associated with protein losing enteropathy, so they lose protein, so they may present with failure to thrive as well. Breastfed infants may not suffer like formula fed infant, so breastfed infant may mislead you a little bit. Diagnosis of Hirschsprung disease is rectal suctioning biopsy. This is the procedure of choice. Biopsy will show the absence of ganglionic cells. Also, another method is anorectal manometry. You will see elevated anal tone. Barium enema will show the narrow rectum, which is the sick segment or the segment without a ganglion or the area of obstruction. Treatment is surgical correction. Surgical correction with temporary colostomy, then the definitive correction 6 to 12 months of age. Rectal prolapse. Important information you need to know about rectal prolapse. The most common cause of rectal prolapse in US is chronic constipation. Chronic constipation is the most common cause due to straining. Diarrhea also can be associated with rectal prolapse. Cystic fibrosis. If you have a child with a rectal prolapse or present with rectal prolapse and failure to thrive, the most likely cause is cystic fibrosis. Management is stool softener, manual reduction. You can do also mild extrarization of the rectal mucosa to as long as 10 to 12 centimeter. So they will heal by contraction and fibrosis, and this will shorten the lax tissue. Similarly, you can do linear mucosal burn, about 8 to 4 lines, and this will heal with contractions and cause shortening of the lax tissue. Recurrent abdominal pain, it is one of the most common causes of visits to pediatrician. So recurrent abdominal pain in children, very common cause to visit the pediatrician because of that, and even the pediatric gastroenterologist. So you need to know it. You need to know it by heart. About 15 to 35% of pediatric population, they suffer from recurrent abdominal pain. Up to one third of the cases they found to be organic. There is a cause you can identify. If no organic cause, is very likely to be functional recurrent abdominal pain. Red flags that might indicate a specific organic disease. So you need to know these red flags. You need to direct your questions in the history to find out about these possible associated condition with organic causes of abdominal pain. A family history of inflammatory bowel disease make the organic cause is very likely. So very important to ask about family history of inflammatory bowel disease like Crohn's or ulcerative colitis. Fever, it is not normal to have fever with abdominal pain. You cannot say it is just a functional abdominal pain. So you need to find out why the patient is having fever. Weight loss. Weight loss make it unlikely to be functional abdominal pain. Night, if the pain is severe enough to wake the child up and not able to go back to sleep, is very unlikely to be functional abdominal pain. Anemia, functional abdominal pain is not associated with anemia. Chronic diarrhea, if the child has a lot of diarrhea, also you have to investigate. Bloody stool, it is not normal to have bloody stool with functional abdominal pain, localized tenderness. Possible causes of recurrent abdominal pain is functional gastrointestinal disorder. For example, functional dyspepsia. So the pain, the abdominal pain is food related, postprandial. Feeling bloating, gas, or heartburn. The child may have gastroesophageal reflux or a history of gastroesophageal reflux. The pain is not relieved by defecation. Not relieved by defecation. Can be associated with intake of NSAID like aspirin or naproxen or ibuprofen. Irritable bowel syndrome. The pain is cramping. So cramping pain with alteration in bowel movement. Constipation, diarrhea, diarrhea, and constipation. But here the pain improves with defecation. So in functional dyspepsia, not relieved by defecation. In IBS is improved with defecation. Abdominal migraine. Abdominal migraine is a possible cause of recurrent abdominal pain in children. History or family history of migraine can be very helpful in the diagnosis of abdominal migraine. The child will present with paroxysmal episode of intense and periumbilical pain more than 1 hour. This can be associated with prodromal symptoms similar to the head migraine, nausea, vomiting, headache, pallor, and photophobia. A period of health lasting weeks, even 2 months, then the pain starts to come back again and may be associated with vomiting, which is like cyclic vomiting as well. This may interfere with normal activities. Recurrent abdominal pain is a diagnosis of exclusion. You need to rule out all the organic causes before you come to the diagnosis of recurrent abdominal pain or functional abdominal pain. Indication for endoscopy, esophagitis, celiac disease, peptic ulcer diseases, Helicobacter pylori, gastritis. Management of recurrent abdominal pain. Avoid NSAID and all the stressors to the stomach. For example, ibuprofen, naproxen. Dietary modification. Increase fibers in diet. Behavioral cognitive therapy. Reassure the parents that this is not organic cause. And this will decrease the stress of the family about the pain. And also will decrease the frequent visits to the ER. And also unnecessary investigation and exposure to radiation. Dicyclomine also can be used for pain to relax the smooth muscle, but you need to keep in mind the side effects and consult the patients or the parents about the side effects: urinary retention, tachycardia, blurring of vision, and dry mouth, which is anticholinergic side effects. Tricyclic antidepressant, for example amitriptyline, can be used to prevent a pain of abdominal migraine. SSRIs or selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors also can be used. You may use also or try acid suppression for a period like 4 weeks and see if this will improve the pain. I will start a new subject with a clinical case scenario. This is an 8-year-old boy with a history of recurrent abdominal pain, weight loss for the last 2 years. He presents with fever 103 Fahrenheit, abdominal pain, and bloody diarrhea. In physical examination, mild tenderness in the left lower quadrant, ESR and CRP are markedly elevated, CBC showed anemia, thrombocytosis, his test for P-ANCA is positive. What is the most likely diagnosis? The key word in this case that this child has chronicity or long time with a recurrent abdominal pain in about 2 years, and he presents now with fever, 103 abdominal pain, and bloody diarrhea. So bloody diarrhea here is the case. So chronicity, and now you have bloody diarrhea, and the ESR and CRP are elevated. Also, his lab is positive for P-ANCA. The most likely diagnosis in this case is ulcerative colitis. Ulcerative colitis is a remitting and relapsing inflammation, comes and goes of the large intestine. So ulcerative colitis affects the large intestine or the colon. It's very important to know that. Ulcerative colitis is less associated with the systemic manifestation than Crohn disease. 25% of the patients with ulcerative colitis require colectomy within 5 years. The risk of colon cancer in ulcerative colitis is very important to remember. The risk increase after 8 to 10 years of the disease, then increase by 0.5 to 1% per year. So the longer time you have the ulcerative colitis, the higher the risk. The risk is delayed by 10 years if limited to the descending colon. So the more extension in the colon, the higher the risk. Screening for colon cancer remember that if patient more than 10 years with ulcerative colitis, you need to screen. More than 10 years, you need to screen. This screening every 1 to 2 years. So if someone has ulcerative colitis for more than 10 years, you need to screen. More than 10 years affected with ulcerative colitis, you need to screen every 1 to 2 years for cancer. Clinical presentation of ulcerative colitis, blood in stool. Blood in stool and diarrhea are the typical presentation. So a patient had or has intermittent abdominal pain with blood, stool and diarrhea, this is, makes the ulcerative colitis very likely, especially if it's chronic, especially if it's for a long time. Abdominal pain, cramping and tenesmus, especially with bowel movement. Severe complication of ulcerative colitis is fulminant colitis. The patient presents with severe abdominal pain, fever, severe anemia, hypoalbuminemia, leukocytosis, more than 5 blood stools per day. This is fulminant colitis, is a severe complication of ulcerative colitis. Here, chronicity is important part of the diagnosis and make the ulcerative colitis more likely than infectious causes of a blood stool. Associated condition with ulcerative colitis, the patient may present with pyoderma gangrenosum, which may be mistaken in the beginning with a spider bite, and then will present with red papule or pustules, then it starts to change to an ulcer, and this is commonly associated with ulcerative colitis, pyoderma gangrenosum. Also, they may present with abdominal pain or inflammation of the common bile duct, sclerosing cholangitis, hepatitis as well, and elevated liver enzymes, back pain and or ankylosing spondylitis, iron deficiency anemia from the chronic blood loss. Remember that after the treatment of the ulcerative colitis, you have to follow up for the side effects of the medication like sulfadiazine and secondary folate or folic acid deficiency. Confirmation of the diagnosis of ulcerative colitis is endoscopy. So endoscopy with biopsy will confirm the diagnosis. Know that colonoscopy and barium enema are contraindicated if the child looks toxic and you suspect toxic megacolon. Plain radiograph will show the loss of hydration in the air-filled colon and is a nice initial test if your patient present to you with ulcerative colitis, especially if it's looking toxic. And in the case of toxic megacolon, the colon will be markedly dilated more than 60 cm. Management of ulcerative colitis, sulfasalazine, mesalamine, oral steroids if moderate to severe colitis. Other medication can be used as a thioprene, cyclosporine, 6-mercaptopurine, infliximab. Let's start another cause of inflammatory bowel disease with a clinical case scenario. This is a 16-year-old boy with history of recurrent aphthous ulcers, recurrent to oral ulcer, presents with intermittent non-bloody diarrhea, right lower quadrant abdominal pain for 4 weeks, anorexia, weight loss, low-grade fever, weakness, and fatigue. On physical examination, he has diffuse abdominal tenderness. ESR and CRP are very elevated, positive anti-saccharomyces cervicae, and negative P. ANCA. What is the most likely diagnosis? The key word in this case, a child present with recurrent oral ulcers, so recurrent ulcers, chronicity also for 4 weeks of abdominal pain and weight loss, so abdominal pain and weight loss for 4 weeks, elevated inflammatory markers CRP and ESR, and ASCA or anti-saccharomyces cervicae antibodies is positive and negative P. ANCA. The most likely diagnosis is Crohn's disease. The most common location the Crohn's disease affect is the small bowel, especially the ileum, and can cause terminal ileitis. Patients with small bowel disease are more likely to present with obstructive pattern with right lower quadrant pain. Clinical presentation of Crohn's disease, diarrhea, and usually non-bloody or not grossly bloody. It is more bloody in cases of ulcerative colitis, and usually it comes and goes, associated with abdominal pain or cramping abdominal pain. The systemic signs is more common with Crohn's disease than ulcerative colitis. Growth failure or failure to thrive is a unique feature of Crohn's disease. It's very important. Most of the kids with chronic disease, they lose weight. Abscess and fistulas, which can affect any organ. Extra-intestinal manifestation of Crohn's disease, oral ulcer. If a child present with recurrent oral ulcer and failure to thrive, you need to keep Crohn's disease in your differential. peripheral arthritis erythema nodosum, which is a tender skin rash usually on the shin of the tibia. Laboratory evaluation, B12 malabsorption, which can cause B12 deficiency anemia with neurological disorder, anemia which is often iron deficiency but also can be B12 as well, oxaluria, which can cause kidney stones because of rapid absorption of oxalate, elevated ESR, hypoalbuminemia, that's why it's very important to check the albumin if you suspect a Crohn disease. High level of anti-saccharomyces cervicae in 55% of the cases of Crohn is more negative in ulcerative colitis. Diagnosis of Crohn disease is colonoscopy. You will see erythema, friability, and loss of vascular pattern. Most specific histology is caseating granuloma. Management, sulfasalazine, mesalamine in mild cases, infliximab in severe cases. PBD test should be done before starting infliximab. Clinical approach to a child present with abdominal pain, diarrhea, and weight loss. Chronicity here is very important and makes the inflammatory bowel disease more likely than infectious causes. If you suspect inflammatory bowel disease, you perform stool studies, CBC, ESR, and albumin. If the study is positive for infectious causes, you go ahead and treat. If the study is not suggestive of inflammatory bowel disease, evaluate for celiac disease, eosinophilic esophagitis, malabsorption disorder. If the study suggestive of inflammatory bowel disease, for example, elevated ESR, hypoalbuminemia, and anemia, you evaluate further by imaging studies or referral to pediatric gastroenterologist. Stool studies very important for evaluation of inflammatory bowel disease. Stool culture for Salmonella, Shigella, E. coli, Campylobacter, and Yersinia. These bacteria can cause abdominal pain and bloody diarrhea, and is very important to rule out infectious causes of, in cases of inflammatory bowel disease if it is suspected. Also, examination of, for Giardia, Cryptosporidium, Clostridium difficile, especially after antibiotic intake, and Amoeba histolytica, especially if there is any travel or history of travel. Fecal markers, they can differentiate between inflammation of the intestine and non-inflammatory causes like irritable bowel syndrome. So calprotectin and lactoferrin, they are elevated in both inflammatory bowel disease and infection. So really they cannot differentiate between inflammatory bowel disease and infection. So you need to know the limitation of this test when you order it. If you have a patient with inflammatory bowel disease and is difficult to differentiate between Crohn and ulcerative colitis, serological markers can be helpful. In cases of Crohn disease, the anti-saccharomyces cervicae antibodies positive more in Crohn than ulcerative colitis. So ASCA or ASCA is more positive in Crohn than ulcerative colitis. The ANCA or anti-neutrophil cytoplasmic antibodies is more positive in ulcerative colitis than Crohn disease. But please do not use this as a screening tool for inflammatory bowel disease. This is not a good screening tool because they can be positive in normal population with no inflammatory bowel disease. Also cannot be used as the only diagnostic tools. They are just helpful, but they cannot be used as a criteria for the diagnosis of inflammatory bowel disease. Irritable bowel syndrome. It is a recurrent abdominal pain and altered bowel movements. Clinical presentation, abdominal pain often relieved with defecation. This is very important. So abdominal pain relieved with defecation. No rectal bleeding, no anemia, no weight loss, no fever. All laboratory are normal. It should be determined that celiac disease is not the cause of the abdominal pain. Very important. Diagnosis of irritable bowel syndrome, it's a diagnosis of exclusion. You need to exclude all organic causes in order to come to this diagnosis, irritable bowel syndrome. Also the typical presentation, which is abdominal pain relieved with defecation, and the patient in between acting normal, no weight loss, all the labs are normal again. Treatment is antispasmodic agents. You may use tricyclic antidepressants. SSRIs can help as well. Gluten sensitive enteropathy or celiac disease. It's a small intestinal mucosal damage because of exposure to wheat products. So the wheat products here For example, wheat, rye, and barley. So wheat, rye, and barley. Pure oats is not considered offending agent. Associated conditions with celiac disease. The commonly associated condition with celiac disease, diabetes type 1 or diabetes mellitus type 1. If you have any child with diabetes mellitus type 1 present with recurrent abdominal pain, you should screen for celiac disease. So celiac disease must be considered in any child with diabetes mellitus type 1 complaining of abdominal pain. Down syndrome also at high risk of having celiac disease, Williams syndrome, Turner syndrome, thyroiditis, selective IgA deficiency. Clinical presentation of celiac disease is diarrhea. This is the most common symptom, diarrhea. Stool is pale, loose, and offensive. Abdominal distension, their tummy is bloated with gas, so they have abdominal distension. Failure to thrive. So this is one of the differential diagnoses of failure to thrive is celiac disease and other causes of malabsorption as well. Anorexia, constipation. So may present with diarrhea, sometimes they present with constipation, but diarrhea is more common than constipation. This is a summary of the gastrointestinal manifestation of celiac disease: abdominal distension, diarrhea, abdominal pain, failure to thrive, anorexia, vomiting, constipation, and weight loss. Non-gastrointestinal manifestation of celiac disease is muscle wasting and loss of muscular power. So these children are weak, are thin, also may present with hypotonia as well. Dermatitis herpetiformis, it's an autoimmune blistering of the skin. The blisters are itchy, commonly located in the elbows, knees, back, and buttocks. These blisters may all develop with other cases like eczema. Also, the treatment of this dermatitis herpetiform, of course, avoiding gluten products, and also respond very well to Dapsone, antibiotic called Dapsone. The dental enamel defects, short stature, delayed puberty, osteoporosis, persistent iron deficiency, anemia. The best initial diagnostic test you can use for screening for celiac disease is anti-tissue transglutaminase antibodies. Anti-tissue transglutaminase antibodies. You may combine this test with IgA level to rule out IgA deficiency because it can give you false negative result. Anti-endomysial IgE antibodies is another option, but it's more difficult to perform, is not widely available. So this test is the best test you can use, is most sensitive and a specific diagnostic test for screening for celiac disease. Of course, the definitive diagnosis or the gold standard is a small intestinal biopsy. Small intestinal biopsy will show flattening of a small intestine. So if this test is positive, this is the next step, is a small intestinal biopsy to confirm the diagnosis. This slide is to compare the duodenal biopsy in a normal child and a child with celiac disease. In a normal child, you will see the villi is elongated and normal absorptive surface area for maximal absorption, and also the crypts here are not thick as here. If you compare to this child, the crypts are thicker. There is a hyperplasia in the crypts in the intestinal wall, and also if you look at here, the villi is shrunken, is flattened, and decreased absorptive surface area. That's why these children, they have malabsorption. Also, it is infiltrated with lymphocytes, which is the characteristics of the biopsy or duodenal biopsy of celiac disease. Management of celiac disease, it's a lifelong exclusion of gluten. Any products containing gluten or wheat should be excluded. So no wheat, no barley, no rye in diet. Follow up with tissue transglutaminase level in 6 months after withdrawal to document reduction in antibodies. Follow up with dietitian. So dietitian here, consultation is very important to let the patient know the products it has gluten, because any small amount can cause damage again. Follow up the growth curve of the child. Cystic fibrosis is a major cause of pancreatic exocrine failure in children and can cause failure to thrive. In this section, I will discuss the GI part of the cystic fibrosis. The pulmonary part will discuss in the respiratory disorder chapter. It is an autosomal recessive disorder because of mutation of the cystic fibrosis transmembrane regulator gene on chromosome 7. So defect in this gene can cause defective chloride channel function, and this can cause dysregulation in epithelial fluid transport in the lung or the pancreas or any organ. Any organ with exocrine glands can be affected in cystic fibrosis disease. Approximately 90% of the patients with cystic fibrosis, they suffer from pancreatic insufficiency and failure to thrive and malabsorption. Clinical presentation of cystic fibrosis, failure to thrive. So any child present with failure to thrive in the first 6 months of life must be investigated for cystic fibrosis. Also, they present with steatorrhea because of malabsorption of fat, and the stool will be a large, pasty, greasy stool and tend to float in the toilet because of the large gas content. Clinical presentation also, they present with hypoalbuminemia because of malabsorption, edema, anemia, a fat-soluble vitamin deficiency, vitamin A, D, E, and K, also calcium oxalate, kidney stones. Diagnosis of cystic fibrosis, the most important initial test to perform in any child with suspected cystic fibrosis is sweat chloride testing. Sweat chloride test. We'll discuss the test result and the how to understand the test result of a sweat chloride test in the pulmonary chapter. Genetic testing to confirm the diagnosis. Stool study here, this is the GI part, is very important. You test for occult blood, fecal leukocytes, pH and reducing substance in the stool. 72-hour stool collection is more accurate. So if you get a choice in the board between qualitative fecal fat or 72 hours is more accurate than this one. This one is just suggestive, but really you cannot really base diagnosis in the qualitative fecal fat. Bacterial culture to rule out any infectious causes, ova and parasites. You test the exocrine function of the pancreas by testing the level of fecal alpha-1 antitrypsin and fecal elastase in the stool. Endoscopy and biopsies to rule out other causes of malabsorption. Management of cystic fibrosis is oral pancreatic enzyme replacement. You need to replace the deficient pancreatic enzyme, but you need to know when it's given in a high dose. When you give the oral pancreatic enzyme in a very high dose, this can cause fibrosing colonopathy. And in this case, the patient will present with abdominal pain, distension, vomiting, and constipation. So recognize this side effect, fibrosing colonopathy. Also, you need to supplement the fat-soluble vitamins. So give the patient vitamin A, vitamin D, vitamin E, vitamin K to prevent the deficiency of these vitamins. Any patient with cystic fibrosis may present with symptoms of fat-soluble deficiency, fat-soluble vitamin deficiency, for example, night blindness or cloudiness of the cornea or follicular hyperkeratosis of the skin. This is suggestive of vitamin A deficiency. Vitamin D deficiency, the patient may present with osteopenia or rickets. So if any signs of rickets, you know that the patient is not receiving the appropriate amount of vitamin D or fat soluble vitamins, which is must be given to any patient with cystic fibrosis. Also vitamin E, which is very important to keep in mind because it's very easy to miss. A patient may have or may present with areflexia or hyporeflexia, ataxia, ophthalmoplegia, or anemia. This is suggestive of vitamin A deficiency associated with cystic fibrosis because of lack of absorption of fat-soluble vitamins. Also remember, if any patient with cystic fibrosis present with easy bruising and bleeding, this you should consider vitamin K deficiency. Also zinc malabsorption, so cystic fibrosis can be associated with zinc malabsorption and present with acrodermatitis enteropathica, which is dermatitis in the anus and the mouth, failure to thrive, chronic diarrhea, and alopecia. The second most common cause of pancreatic insufficiency after cystic fibrosis is Shwachman-Diamond syndrome. If you have any child present with failure to thrive, pancreatic insufficiency or malabsorption, and neutropenia, think of Shwachman-Diamond syndrome. They may also have skeletal abnormalities. So again, Shwachman-Diamond syndrome is two things: failure to thrive because of pancreatic insufficiency and neutropenia. This video is for educational purpose. Please consult the physician of your child or your physician for the correct diagnosis and the proper treatment. The next video will be the gastrointestinal chapter, part 3, from page 276 to page 290. Thank you for watching.